I drilled the bottom and top piece for a 5/8 rod. I put a piece of scrap down here just to give a ledge for these side slats to butt up against. This piece I drilled before I put the spiral in because I knew it was going to be difficult to drill later. And I made this part to where it will fit in here. And there's a little ledge around there just to keep that from falling through. Now I'm going to put a spot of glue on there just to hold that in position so I don't have to worry about this thing wiggling around when I'm putting the slats on here. All of my side slats are a 1/2 inch wide, 1/4 inch thick piece of wood cut from a 2x4. It took 4 13 inch long pieces of 2x4 flattened, squared, and sliced into pieces and planed to an even thickness to make 50 plus of these pieces. You're always going to have some that are going to break. These are 1/2 inch wide. I marked 1/4 inch in the center and marked it for a taper. I rough cut those on the disc sander and then flattened them on a belt sander, just like I did in the video for building my first dust collector. These are not beveled. They're just flat side. You can see these all go together. Initially, I'm just going to glue some slats on here between the top and the bottom support. So I put a little glue on here and tack that to the top and that bottom support. I'm going to close one eye. I'm going to stand back and just visually center this in the center of that 5/8 dowel and this at the center of the 5/8 dowel. If you want to, you can put a square in there. Put that square in the center. You look up and down that. It'll be straight and let that dry. Those will be our support and something that we're going to glue the other slats to later. I'm just putting a stringer of glue down the side, a little bit at the top. I'm going to stick that in there. We want to butt these together pretty good at the top. Leave a little space at the bottom. Put a square on there. Kind of look at it, see that we're keeping it fairly straight. We'll just work our way around here. And again, we do not want to put any glue on this bottom plate for the rest of these because we will have to knock this loose. I have added these slats all the way around. And that glue is making contact in some places and not in others. And it's trying to run and drip out here and there. Don't worry about it. This is a sticky, gooey mess. Nowhere in the description of this video did I say it was going to be pretty. We have room for one more slat in each of these positions. After I put the first four slats in, I let the glue dry for a little bit, and I started adding these. After I got about six of them in, I put this rubber band down there. That rubber band's enough just to keep a little tension on there, hold the bottom in because it's not being glued to that bottom support and keeps everything in position. This has taken me about 15 minutes to do. When you cut these sticks and sand them, they're not going to stay straight. Let's see if we can find that one. You see that one down there? That's crooked as can be. This wood has been drying in my shop for a couple of years. In fact, as a 2x4, I was going to return to Lowe's. It looked more like an airplane propeller than it did a 2x4. But seeing how I was going to just make a bunch of sticks, I cut up about half of that to make these. And still had sap in the center of the wood. So when you cut this, it doesn't make much difference how old it is. You cut it, those sticks are going to bend and twist on you. Just cut them out, sand them to shape, glue them in here the best you can. And it'll work just fine. for a 7 1/4 inch diameter disc and a 1/2 inch wide slat, I calculated it would take 45 and a half to go all the way around. It has taken 46. These are not exactly a 1/2 inch, and the spacing down at the bottom is not exactly 1/4 inch. All of the slats are in there. I've kind of gone around and wiped off the glue with my finger. I'm gonna leave it alone and come back out here tomorrow, and I'm gonna put some more glue in between these spots. Kind of interesting. I was running pieces of wood like this through the planer, getting these all to the same thickness to make the slats for the cyclone separator. This came out of that crooked 2x4 I was talking about, and this piece of wood had been in a hot garage drying out for a couple of years. And when I ran this through the planer, I sliced into this pocket of pine tar, and that was about the consistency of honey. You could pick that up and that would try to run out of there. And then as it went through the roller hit it, and it was like a printing press. It went stamp, stamp. And then the next piece of wood came along, it was stamp, stamp, stamp. Nice and sticky and gooey. Made a bit of a mess out of my rollers for a while. If you don't like what I've done, you think you want to try and make a larger one using a larger plastic pipe, you follow the same proportions, it should turn out just fine. The top disc was 7 1/4 times pi, then divided by the 1/2 inch width of the slats at the top, came out 45 and a half, we say 46. The bottom is a 4 inch disc times pi, then divided by the 46 pieces, came out 0.27, okay, say 1/4 inch. So I'm going to have a 1/2 inch wide stick, and I'm going to taper it down to 1/4 inch at the bottom, and that stick is 13 inches long. Bottom piece of scrap was just glued in three places. I put a screwdriver in there, knocked it loose, put a slight taper on this bottom ring so it will fit the bottom of this. I do not want to glue this on until after I get through filling all these on the outside, and I run that across the belt sander to even it up a little bit. This ring will just be in the way until then. This whole project is made out of a bunch of junk scrap wood. Even the plastic pipe was a piece of pipe that was left over from another project. It's all scarfed up and dirty and what have you. 2x4 was a twisted, warped piece of wood that wasn't going to be good for much of anything else except cut in short pieces. The plywood is scrap wood. The bottom is a piece of scrap wood. We're going to knock this out of here when we're done anyway. The assembly and construction of this is extremely non-critical. Just put it together and it's going to work. Now I'm going to take sawdust and glue and fill in these big gaps on the outside. I'm going to rough sand this, and then I'm going to install this ring. Then I will knock out the center support so I can reach inside here and finish caulking the inside. On the original dust collector, this was 3 inch. It was difficult for me to get my hand in there. This is 4 inch. It'll be real easy to get inside there. All the cracks and crevices have been plastered with a mixture of tight bond glue and sawdust. I just take the sawdust and I start mixing in the wood glue, add a little bit of water to thin it, and start plastering it on there. The negative side of this would be that this is oak sawdust. And typically, when I mix that with tight bond glue, when that dries, that'll get kind of black. I'm using a tool like this to push that mixture of sawdust and wood glue into all those cracks. And I do not want to get so vigorous in doing that on the bigger cracks that I cause that to extrude or protrude on the inside. I'm just filling the outside. That will later be held in place quite nicely by polyurethane varnish. Later, I will enter through the bottom and I will plaster all the cracks in that on the inside with a wood filler, then wipe it down with a wet rag so I end up with a smooth finish on the inside. I've knocked the top and bottom support out of here, mainly to let more air in there so it'll dry out. And I've taken this ring and I've put it around here just to hold that in shape. especially until everything dries. This is still a little bit flexible. I hold a flashlight in here, and while this is not exactly tangential to this inside surface, material will come in here and it will start going around here easy enough. Material that comes into one of these cyclones is moving right along. If you've ever had a chance to see one of these made out of clear plastic, material that enters the cyclone is going to move downward, and typically it will make about 1.5 turns or less, and it's in the bucket. This has been sanded. I've put a little wood filler in here to fill a few holes. I changed my bottom ring to this piece of particle board. And then I sanded this to a nice radius so you can reach in and out of here without getting a splinter. Making this the way I did, not putting a bevel on these sticks, it puts most of the big joints on the outside. There are a few gaps on the inside. It makes it pretty smooth on the inside. And it's the inside that we want to be smooth. We're not that concerned about what the outside looks like. So I'm going to put a glove on, and using some wood filler, I'm going to reach in here and I'm going to push that wood filler into what gaps and cracks are in there and wipe it back and forth. I'm going to use a wet towel to keep that wood filler wet, push it into the joints, wipe it back and forth, and a couple of dry towels to take out the excess, and then we'll let it dry. And to fill the inside cracks, I'm using Elmer's wood filler. And this is some of that stuff that they've screwed around with to where it's purple. It's supposed to change colors as it dries. This is a little bit thick, so I'm just going to put just a little bit of water in here. I'm going to mix that up. So instead of being a thick, chunky stuff that came out of the container, now it's nice and soft, and we'll be able to push that into the cracks and crevices. I have a vinyl glove on. Let's take a chunk of this, put it on my fingers, reach in here and go all the way down to the bottom, start pushing that into place. You need to work lengthwise to try and push that material into those cracks, and that you can end up with an air bubble in there and you'll have a hard time getting it in otherwise. But you play with it for a few minutes, you'll figure it out. All those cracks and crevices have been filled and it's dried. I run a sanding sponge around inside there just to knock off any cat whiskers or anything sticking up. There'll be two coats of polyurethane varnish on the inside and two coats on the outside, and that will seal that up. While I said I don't think that this needs any sort of guidance to become tangential, I put a little stop block in there. And I made a piece of wood to go inside. The purpose of that stop block is when I get glue smeared all over that piece of wood, it'll help me slide that into the correct position. Because once I got my arm inside there, I can't see what I'm doing. It's all being done by feel. Placing a high-intensity flashlight in the entry of the spiral. The light follows the pipe around. It gives you a pretty good idea of how material will enter the cyclone. The cyclone's been given two coats of polyurethane, nice and shiny. Its inside surface is smooth and shiny. That means your collected material will slide around there very easily. To make a lid to seal on top of a 5-gallon bucket, the easiest way to get a flat material is to get a piece of this particle board. It is flat. I cut out a wood ring to glue on there, and that will keep that centered on that 5-gallon bucket. Before I glue that on there, I masked off this area where the glue will be. I painted this with polyurethane varnish. When that's dry, I'll sand it with a random orbital, see how smooth it is. That'll probably be good enough. If need be, I'll give it a second coat, sand it again, then glue that on there and varnish the rest of it. After I had the bucket lid completed, I mounted the ring on here. I put a little bit of a sealant between this ring and the lid, and then installed the four screws. Inside there, you can see the center pipe, which is sticking down about 4 inches. The center pipe is sticking about 4 inches into this cyclone, and that's working very efficiently for me. During the construction of the cyclone, this spiral only came around to about this point. So this was completely out of the way for the rest of the construction. After construction, I glued these on, which turns and angles down slightly to give your collection hose a little bit of a droop towards the floor, which is where it's wanting to head anyway. When I put the center section in here, I also angled that downwards, and this is one that will connect to a hose that goes to your shop vac. Then I put some supporting material on both sides of this, just to support that pipe and that tube in case it falls over and hits the ground or something. And I've put a little bit of that around here as well. I glued this piece on here, and then about an hour or so later, I put a hose on here and I started testing this in the shop. And this, after a couple of hours, just broke off. That was a mistake. You need, when you glue these, you put it together and set it to one side for a day or two. It takes a while for the volatiles to boil off in that glue joint. Once that glue is set up hard, this is tough. I have squeezed and bent and dropped these things in the shop in the process of designing this setup. And if you leave that alone after you glue it, you're not going to have a problem with that.